One of the classic questions that Jesus poses to his followers is this: who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? It's a simple and it's also a timeless question. Every culture since the time of Jesus has had its own images of Jesus. And so the way that we think about Jesus and have grown up thinking about Jesus is sort of defined by the culture and the time or age that we grow up. When Jesus asks his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" Some of the disciples responded, "Well, some people say that you're John the Baptist." Others said, "You're the prophet Elijah." And still others said, "You're the prophet Jeremiah," or one of the other prophets. If people knew Jesus then as they responded with a variety of answers, is it no surprise to us that we also would respond to that question, "Who do you say that I am?" with a variety of answers? I think one of the classic identity statements that Jesus makes of himself is found in the lesson that is read every Palm Sunday. The Gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke all give an account of Jesus' entry into Jerusalem around the year 31 AD. And we've come to call this the triumphal entry, or the procession of palms. It's a very deliberate procession into the city of Jerusalem by Jesus and his followers. And this parade is highly symbolic. Matthew tells us that Jesus and his disciples draw near to Jerusalem, and they come to the Mount of Olives. The Mount of Olives being on the east side of Jerusalem. And you see the Mount of Olives in the picture on the screen. The Mount of Olives has long been associated in the minds of Jewish people with messianic hopes. This is the spot that the Messiah would come and usher in a new age of peace. In this area, there are thousands of Jewish graves. It's quite an expensive place to be buried if you are a Jew, but if you're a prominent Jew, this is where you want to be buried, above ground. And then when the Messiah comes, as tradition says, you will be the first to rise when that new age comes. The folks that will be going on our tour in October will get to see this place, the graves, and some of the spots associated with the Mount of Olives. It's a holy place, and we've created our own wailing wall here on the first Sunday of Lent. About twice, I forget, twice a year perhaps, all of the prayers in the wailing wall are removed and buried on the Mount of Olives. The prophet Zechariah in chapter 14, verses 1 through 5 of the Hebrew Scriptures, our Old Testament, speaks of a day when the Lord will defend Jerusalem and his feet shall stand on the Mount of Olives. The final five chapters of this scroll, now the book of Zechariah, focuses on the coming age of God and God's servant who will draw all nations together in peace. This part of the scroll of Zechariah is quoted in the gospel account of Jesus' final week in Jerusalem more than any other scripture in all of the Bible. Jesus knew Zechariah. He knew that scroll by heart. And he knew the new age it proclaimed. The prophet's words had helped silence the myth of the Roman Empire That victory is achieved by might or power. That nations are brought into peaceful relations with each other under the power of one who conquers. In other words, the Pax Romana to a T. Victory through military victory. Or strength. Matthew knows that if we don't see Zechariah clearly, then we don't know Jesus very well. In ancient times, people who suffered war and defeat were forced to witness parades. And in your screen, you see the Arch of Titus on the Palatine Hill in the Forum of Rome. And this arch was erected as Titus, the military general, the son of Vespasian, the emperor, rode into Jerusalem, destroyed the temple, and brought the spoils of the temple back with him. Underneath this arch, you'll see a pictorial scene of Titus and his armies bringing back the menorah, the temple treasures into the city of Rome. It's believed to this day that many of those copper, bronze, and gold objects that were once a part of the temple were inserted into today's Colosseum. You can't see it because it's all been stolen, but you see little holes where it once stood. So people witnessed the conquering nation of Rome parading on war horses, marching captives to their doom, and bringing the treasures of conquered nations back to Rome. But Zechariah describes a humble ruler who enters not on a horse, but on a donkey to bring peace to the world. I know it seems strange, but riding a donkey was also a symbol of royal status. Kings also rode donkeys. They rode either a donkey or a horse, and that animal had symbolism to it. If a king rode a horse, it was an example of a military victory, a military king. If a king rode a donkey, it was a symbol of peace. And so Jesus enters Jerusalem as a king, or a military hero, who is bringing in peace. Think about it. Jesus, the Prince of Peace, rides into Jerusalem, meaning City of Peace, and ushers in a reign of peace. Matthew reports that the crowd went ahead of Jesus, and also those who followed Jesus were shouting, "Hosanna! Hosanna to the Son of David! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna to the highest heaven." Hoshna, Hoshana means save us. And we know, as Matthew tells us in verse 10, when Jesus enters Jerusalem, the passage says the whole city was in turmoil. The Greek word used in this passage for turmoil is the word that is used for earthquake tremors. So the arrival of this messianic one literally shook the city and brought it to its knees. Matthew's presentation of Palm Sunday stresses the fact that everyone is affected by the presence of Jesus. What is described for us is the effect that Jesus had on those who followed. What is described for us in the scene of Matthew is that when people find themselves in the presence of Jesus, the response is joy, it's celebration, because in Jesus they find the hope of salvation, the hope for deliverance. They find a kingdom that will be ushered in, that is built upon peace. For people who are suffering from exploitation and injustice, and for the victims of war, especially those from the Roman Empire or Roman domination, for those on the bottom who had no hope of ever getting on top again, that is cause for excitement. It might not be so much for us, because for the most part, we are on top. But for the people who were on the bottom, there was great cause for hope. This morning, God calls each one of us to become a part of the Palm Sunday crowd, so that we too, each one of us, might participate in the life of Jesus, the one we call our Christ. The best sort of a parade, as you heard the children say, is one in which we become participants. And so Jesus calls us today to participate, to follow his example, to lead not by power but in service, humble service, not to dominate, but to create spaces or circles of shalom, which means wholeness and harmony and peace that lifts up everyone around us. So when Jesus posed the question to Peter, "Who do you say that I am?" Peter said, "You are God's Messiah." And in New Testament translation, that means the Christ. And Jesus took this title and carried it all the way to the cross. We invite you to become a part of a community that seeks to follow. To follow in the ways of Jesus. The ways of peace and justice for everyone. Won't you come? And I will now invite my pastor's class to come forward as we sing a hymn.